Blessed evening, everyone, and those who are joining us tonight, and welcome to our Bible study night. My name is Mary Grace Damo. I'm one of the primary leaders of Pag-asa Center under the leadership of Pastor Doc Ambat and Pastor Ashay Ambat. And I would like to acknowledge and thank our pastor, Pastor Doc and Pastor Ashay Ambat, for allowing me or for giving me the opportunity to teach tonight. And I would also like to acknowledge our pastor, Pastor Gosh Ambat in Pag-asa Center, Pastor Allen Bacani in PC Philippines, and Pastor Ben Ford Nadorata in PC Island. And also, I would like to acknowledge my co-primaries, all the cell leaders, and all my brethren in Pag-asa Center. And most especially, I would like to thank the Holy Spirit, where my wisdom, courage, and strength comes from. Without the Holy Spirit, I may not able to do this because I am also a student of the Word. Welcome once again. Tonight, we are going to study 1 John chapter 5, but we will split this chapter into two parts. The first part is from 1 John 5 verses 1 to 11, and the second is from verses 12 to verse 21, and we will discuss the second part next Wednesday at the same time. And before we start our topic tonight, first let us ask the Lord Jesus Christ to guide us and empower us through the Holy Spirit. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, truly Lord, that you are an amazing God. You are an awesome God. You are the great I Am, the King of glory, the Lord of hosts. Great are you, Lord, and worthy of all praises, honor, and the highest adoration. For you are the sovereign Lord, the Almighty, the Holy One, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. No one like you, Lord. Nothing compares to you, Father, the one who was, who is, and the is to come. Father, as we come before you tonight, we humble ourselves and asking for your forgiveness. If there is still not right in our hearts, Lord, cleanse us, have mercy on us, and create in us a pure and holy heart. Forgive us, Father, for all the things that we do that we should not have done, and for the things that we didn't do that we should have done. Thank you, Father, for tonight, for giving me the privilege to teach and using me as the mouthpiece of your word. Thank you, O Holy Spirit, for guiding me, leading me, and giving me the courage to speak tonight. Be with us, O Holy Spirit, until the end of our lesson. And help us, Lord, to understand and receive your word with faith. I pray for your double portion of your anointing as I speak with power in the name of Jesus. I pray for those who are listening tonight to open their hearts and enlighten their mind about the truth of our Lord Jesus Christ. That whoever heard your message tonight, Lord, there will be a transformation in their lives, that their lives will not be the same again, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, and we love you. In the mighty name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Good evening and welcome once again, my brothers and sisters in Christ. The title of the first part of 1 John chapter 5, verse 1 to 11 is Born of God. In this chapter, emphasizes the believer's ability to overcome the world through the power of Christ. John gives the testimony regarding Jesus, the Son of God. 1 John chapter 5 starts with an important impression that everyone who puts their faith in Jesus Christ is born of God. Those who truly love God also love their spiritual brothers and sisters. We show this love for others through obeying God's commands. Those born of God are overcomers. John highlights the power of believers to conquer the sins and temptations of this world through a relationship with God. It also focused on Jesus as the Son of God, that He came by water and blood, and mostly likely it refers to His baptism and crucifixion. In this chapter, the Spirit agrees with the testimony of Jesus as God's Son. Whoever believes has this testimony within them. This witness proves that through Christ we have everlasting life. Even as early as John wrote this letter, Christians were facing discouragement from the false teachers over their salvation. In verse 1, being born of God is the source of love. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God, and everyone who loves the Father loves his child as well. John's idea that love as a commandment from God is a necessary action by believers. Showing love to others is how we demonstrate that we are born of God. Being born of God is the result of faith in Christ. The love of God is inseparable from love of other people. True believers must also love other believers. John gives importance of love, but he never wants anyone to believe that he earns salvation by loving others. The word "everyone believe that Jesus is the Christ is born of God" are very understandable words, but it contains a profound meaning. The phrase "born again" means born from above. It is a special or spiritual birth that happens when the Holy Spirit gives a person eternal life. Being born of God means loving others who are also children of God, and gives a person a new heart that wants to please God. Where there is real faith in Jesus Christ as the anointed of God, there is the evidence that the new birth has taken place. Let the first, the best, and the clearest proof of our regeneration be the fact that we very truly do and believe in our heart that Jesus is the Christ. Everyone that loves Him loves His child also. If we love the Father, we love the Son. If we love God, we love all His people. All who are born into the divine family are the objects of our affection. We are born of God when we put our trust on Jesus and on His saving work in our lives, a trust in and reliance on Jesus as Messiah. To love all others in the family of God means that you do not limit your love to your own denomination or your own circle or even to your own family. Amen. And in verse 2 to 3 is the demonstration of God's love. We know we love God's children if we love God's and obey His commandments. For love leads imitation. If we truly love the children of God, we shall imitate them. And they are known by these distinguishing characteristics, that they love their Heavenly Father and keep His commandments. God recognizes us as His children when we carry out His commands. John, referring to the commands of Jesus for Christians, are not called to keep these commandments out of obligations or mere duty. Rather, they are commanded to express their love of God by loving their fellow believers. Amen. In verse 3, it says, "For this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments, and His commandments are not burdensome." So loving God is not just external obedience, but rather it's saving a heart, or it's having a heart for God that doesn't find commandments burdensome. A true Christians believe that God's commands are not burdensome, but rather it is a blessing for those who have faith in Christ and love for God. Obedience to God's commands is a result of love for God. God's commandments are not oppressive for believers. Those who love God obey His commandments to honor Him, with the Holy Spirit prompting them to do so. A holy life is the best possible proof of true love to God. As true believers and followers of Jesus Christ, we are delightful and not sorrowful in the commandments of God, and we are hopeful that we could perfectly conform to the divine will of God. In verse 5 or 4 to 5, being born of God is the source of victory. Verse 4 says, "For whatever is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith." Those who are born of God overcome the world through faith. And those who have faith in Christ believe they have eternal life. As the believers, faith empowers them to overcome false prophets. They are joyful in keeping God's command and to love others. Help them to overcome the barriers of culture and society. Our faith refers to believers' faith in God and His saving work through Jesus Christ. Those who trust in Christ's death and resurrection share His victory over the forces of evil at work in the world. Since believing on Him is the key to being born of God, the key to victory is faith. Not only an initial come to the altar and get saved faith, but a consistently abiding faith, an ongoing reliance and trust upon Jesus Christ. The life of abiding faith and trust in Jesus Christ is the life that overcomes the pressures and temptations of the world. In verse 5 says, "Who is he who overcomes the world, but he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God?" This tells us we overcome primarily because of who we are in Christ, not because of what we do. We overcome because we are born of God, and we are born of God because we believe that Jesus is the Son of God. No one else can overcome the world, but where there is true faith in Christ, it creates within a heart a holy bravery by which the conquest of the world is achieved. The law tells us to overcome the world, but the gospel of God's grace authorizes us to do it. It is faith in Jesus which is, first of all, the evidence of the new birth, and which is, afterwards, the weapon flourished by the newborn soul, with which it fights till it gained the victory over the world. According to Charles Spurgeon, the word faith does not merely mean to believe, but to trust, to confide in, to commit to, entrust with, and so forth. The very marrow of the meaning of faith is confidence in, reliance upon. In Christ, as we abide in Him, we are overcomers because Jesus Christ overcomes the world. John 16:33 says, "In the world you will have tribulation, but be in good cheer, I have overcome the world." Amen. In verse 6 to 8, absolutely identifying who Jesus, the Son of God, is, the one on whom we must believe. Verse 6 says, This is he who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ, not only by water, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit who bears witness, because the Spirit is truth. Water and blood, mostly likely referring to Jesus Christ's baptism and crucifixion. The Spirit also agrees with the testimony of Jesus as God's Son. Taken together of the reference of water and blood encapsulate the ministry of Jesus from its beginning at His baptism to His sacrificial death on the cross. For John, confessing that Jesus is the Son of God, meant confessing Him as the Anointed One of God, the Christ, who truly suffered and died on the cross. The two must go together. And no man will ever rightly value the cleansing water unless he equally values the atoning blood. It is said by some that the preaching of the doctrine of the full and free forgiveness of sin, which is bestowed upon all who exercise faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, will load men to carelessness of life. But it has quite the opposite effect. The cleansing of the life by the sanctifying power of the Holy Spirit through the Word becomes incumbent upon us when once we are washed from sin in the precious blood of Jesus. The atonement is the true guarantee of holiness, because holiness is what we give to God, and it is the result of being born of God. In verse 7 to 8 says, "For there are three that bear witness in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one." Verse 8, "And there are three that bear witness on earth, the Spirit, the water, and the blood, and these three agree as one." So the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit are bear witness in heaven, and the bear witness on earth are the Spirit, the water, and the blood. John identifies the Spirit as a testifier that confirms the truth. The three witnesses in verse 7 emphasizes the oneness of God as Father, the Word, which is Jesus, and the Spirit. The Father, Son, which is the Word or Jesus, and the Holy Spirit working together as equal yet distinct persons. In regards to Jesus, the three witnesses in verse 3 are in agreement. What a beautiful and blessing it is for us to get the witness of these three, even here on earth, in the new life which is created within our souls by the Holy Spirit, the daily cleansing of our life, but that the same blessed Spirit through the Word, and the continual application by the Spirit of that precious blood by which peace is given to the conscience and sin is put away from the heart. Amen. In verse 9 to 10, the witness of God is greater than the witness men. Verse 9 says, "If we receive the witness of men, the witness of God is greater. For this is the witness of God which he has testified of his Son." John assumes people will receive the testimony of men, so they ought to be willing to accept statement from God. John observes that the testimony of God is greater. He argues from the lesser to the greater, noting the obvious belief to his readers that God is greater than people. John points out that the testimony of God is greater than of men, making his a powerful and convincing arguments that Jesus is the Son of God. Every day and everybody receives the witness of men regarding so many things. Therefore, we should have much more confidence in the witness of God when he tells us who Jesus is. John doesn't want us to believe with blind faith. Instead, our faith is to be based on reliable testimony, and we have the most reliable testimony possible, the witness of God. In verse 10, it says, "He who believes in the Son of God has the witness in himself. He who does not believe, God made him a liar, because he has not believed the testimony that God has given to his Son." This witness proves that through Christ, we have everlasting life. John wrote this letter. Christians were facing discouragement from false teachers over their salvation. When we believe on Jesus, we receive the Holy Spirit as an inner confirmation of our standing before God. Romans 8 verse 16 said, "The Spirit Himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God." When we refuse to believe on Jesus, we reject the testimony God has given of His Son. Therefore, we call God a liar with our unbelief. The burden of proof stands against those who deny that Jesus came in the flesh. They are disputing with God, who speaks only truth. In verse 11, assurance of life in the Son of Jesus. "And this is the testimony, that God has given us eternal life, and this life is in His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ." John has already mentioned testimony several times in the last few verses. Here he adds a references to both eternal life from God and life in the Son. These are additional reassurance to the Christian that John has provided a tools to use in this letter. A Christian can be confident in their salvation. God has given us eternal life, and this life is in His Son. This is God's essential message to man, that eternal life is a gift from God, received in Jesus Christ. It is all about Jesus, and living in Jesus is the evidence of eternal life. Amen. 1 John 5, chapter 1 to 11 teaches us that those who believe in Jesus Christ as the Son of God have been born of God and will overcome the world. Those who believe in Jesus Christ should have confidence and assurance of eternal life. Those who love God will want to obey His commands and please Him. Those who have been set free by Christ should be grateful and thankful to God every day. Those who know that the battle has been won should share the good news of peace, treaty with others. Those who have faith in Christ should live their lives in service to God and share this testimony with others. God's love brings life even out of brokenness and death. Idols are anything that steals attentions, worship, and adoration away from God. And those who love God should love others better and love God undistracted. Amen. So I hope and pray that everyone who joined us this evening have learned something that gives them something to look forward and encouragement to God to come back next week for the continuation of the lesson this evening. Before we go, let us end up in prayer. Let us pray. Abba, Father in heaven, we thank You for Your word today, Lord. We are born of God, and because of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, we have the confidence, believing that we are overcomers. Thank You, Lord, for Your mercy and grace that gives us the ability to put our faith and trust in You as we heard Your message this evening. Help us, Father, to be faithful and live a life worthy of You, a holy life. As we acknowledge that we are a recipient of Your love, Your mercy, and Your grace, help us to show our love for You as we love others. As we continue, Lord, to walk with our journey in faith, give us the power, the ability to conquer the sin and temptation of this world through our intimate relationship with You, Lord. Help us to keep Your commandments, and it will not burdensome to us. Instead, a joyful one. As we continue to believe in You, Lord, we will have the confidence and assurance of our eternal life. Increase our faith and obedience to You, Lord, and help us to work out our salvation with fear and trembling. We thank You, Lord, and we love You. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. So good night, everyone, and see you next Wednesday. and God bless.